Hey everybody, welcome to episode number 6 of Inbound Now. I'm joined here with a very special guest, Mr. Chris Brogan. Chris is the president of Human Business Works, a blogging extraordinaire, co-founder of PodCamp, a New York Times bestseller and co-author of the book Trust Agents, and he's also on the advisory board here at HubSpot. So welcome to the show, Chris.
Super happy to be here, David. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's no problem. It's no problem. So I wanted to get you on the show.
We might have to start again.
Fail. I can just kind of maybe edit around that. I don't know. Or just keep it in.
Keep it in.
Yeah, it adds to the human nature of the show. All right, cool. Yep. So I wanted to get you on the show today to talk a little bit about what it takes to become a trust agent. And then transition into, some blogging tips you picked up over, the past 9+ years that you have been blogging and growing, your audience and community. And then we'll take a look into the future, and I want to get your, opinions on where things are going and what we should be looking out for. Sound cool?
That sounds perfect.
All right, let's do it. So Trust Agents, the book Trust Agents, I read it. It was an awesome book. So what exactly is a trust agent, and how can a marketer become one?
The trust agent is the kind of person who, inside an organization, is translating that organization's presence on the web, how to be human at a distance. The idea is that we have all this marketing speak, we have all this PR speak, etc. What a trust agent is somebody that you get the feeling that you're doing business with that company through that person. The early examples of that were Frank Eliasson when he was at Comcast, who's now moved on to Citibank. There is Jenny Sisney from Kodak, who is Kodak's chief blogger. And so a lot of us in this space, when we think Kodak, we think Jenny. There's Matt Cutts from Google, who's their search guru. And, not many of us have access to Larry Page and Sergey Brin, but we can talk to Matt, and Matt can come back and represent and talk about what Google's doing. Even more than, say, Melissa Mayer, who is certainly someone who has a strength and a presence inside Google and who was sort of heading their communications practice, we've got somebody like Matt who is more on our level and someone that we can actually talk about. So, to me, a trust agent is somebody who uses these new web-based tools to connect and build a relationship and really help with the humanizing elements of doing business.
Right. And you mentioned in the book, kind of Dunbar's number, where there's 150 connections you can maintain, and you want to kind of be the go-to person where you connect all these different people from different industries. And I thought that was a really cool tip.
Right. Well, at the time of this recording, I just launched a blog post showing my interview with Disney CEO Bob Iger. And so for a guy like me to sit across from the guy who heads Disney, a multi-billion dollar corporation, that makes me part of that 150 because the Disney people trust me enough that they gave me that relationship. Tomorrow, I'll be meeting with the head of Humana, which is a healthcare company down in Louisville, Kentucky. I'll be meeting with their CEO, Mike, and the idea being that I can be part of that 150. So the idea, can you hinge and be sort of the go-to person, be the elbow of every deal in a lot of different communities wherein which you still add some kind of value and you still interpret things in a way or help people find the right people? That's kind of the goal.
Right. Awesome. So yeah, it was a great book, and I would recommend it to all the viewers out there to check it out. There's one of my favorite tips from the book was your idea of having a 12-to-1 sharing ratio, where you share 12 times as much other people's stuff. So where did this kind of come about, and why do you think it's important that people do it this way?
Totally made up the number. It just seemed like if I started with some number, people would have a better guideline than just share more than others. And it gets quoted all the time, like it's Bible now. And that makes me laugh. The idea, though, is that, as marketers came onto these social platforms, most especially Twitter, I just saw them saying me. And what they don't understand is that if we were at a cocktail party together, that's really not how you're going to make me. That's not how you're going to make a relationship start. You're going to say things like, well, tell me a little bit more about you, or, oh, my friend David does that. He's involved in that space. This is how we make friends and build relationships. And these tools, even though we're using them for marketing and for business, have to be used in that way. We have to use them to sort of foment a relationship, because if we don't, we're just email marketing down a different channel, and poor email marketing, and we're just sort of smashing our ads against people. Well, I mean, there's already existing models for that, and they don't work. Why not try something new, and why not try something that could have a different value proposition?
Right, right. I definitely agree. So I mean, it was a great book, and I definitely, everyone should go pick it up, Trust Agents, co-authored with Julian Smith. So I wanted to switch gears a little bit, because you've probably done 1,000 interviews on Trust Agents, and you're probably sick and tired of it, so I just wanted to keep that short. Let's switch gears and start talking about blogging.
Sure.
Because you're a prolific blogger, you've been doing it for 9+ years, and you know, over on your blog, chrisbrogan.com, every single post you put out, you know, kind of has hundreds of comments and people retweeting it. So how did you kind of foster and grow this?
So I've been blogging since 1998, so closer to 11 years. And it took me 8 years to get my first 100 readers. And partly because I was doing it wrong for a long time, and partly because I think the space wasn't ready for people yet. And then as around, say, 2005 came around, 2006, then my numbers started going up a little bit. And I would say that how I do it is I tend to have a few very set rules. Be helpful, give away everything you can, and make sure you put posts together that people feel they can relate to and have something to add to. The reason I get a lot of comments is because I don't write as if I'm the definitive expert. I write as if I have an opinion and I'm looking for other people's opinions to shore mine up. Forevermore, that gives me lots of people saying, I think you're full of it and here's why. And somebody else will come back and say, no, that's right on the money. It's how it's worked at my company. And I like both. As long as people have, you know, an educated opinion, it's very useful. Being useful and providing information that's helpful to people and giving away as much of the secret sauce as I can, I just get more and more people coming back to my site because I'll share everything. And then it's really funny because I see my detractors using my advice. I see them changing their sites to kind of match what I suggested would be a great idea, and then coming back to my site and telling me I'm a piece of poop. So, but I don't mind because my detractors aren't really competitors in my mind. They're people out there trying to get their own clients. They're welcome to my clients if they can get them. And I would rather compete on my excellence than worry about who's running in the race beside me. In blogging, that translates to me to writing daily. And not every post is a winner, and not every post is the very best, but I do try to put effort into it every single day, and I try to make every post a winner as best as I can.
Right, right. And another thing you mentioned on your blog, you know, there's a difference in your mind between having an audience and having a community, and it's the way in which you face the chairs, which I thought was pretty clever. So how would you transition, you know, so you have an audience of people. How do you kind of foster that community aspect of it?
So you encourage two-way conversations. You encourage people in the comments to interact with each other. You highlight that when it happens. Sometimes I've taken, people have written huge comments and I've made those into blog posts and said, you know, a post from the comment section. Well, once you get rewarded like that, two things happen. You bring your crowd to look at it. Hey, Chris blogged the whole post out of my comment. And then the other is, you get that kind of a reward, that kind of recognition, so you come and participate more. So I do a lot of things to try to reward participation inside of my community, and I try to be the number one commenter on my own blog. The other thing is I see a lot of bloggers. There's two ways to do this. One is bloggers who religiously think you have to comment on every single comment. And I think that there's a benefit because everyone feels heard. There's a negative that, you know, a lot of times you're just writing, hey, thanks. So I try to only add in where there's a value to add, or if I, you know, have a snarky quote to add. The being number one commenter on your blog, though, means that people know that you respect them and that you recognize their time and attention and that you've given them help. And if I fall down anywhere in my efforts to be helpful, that's the one. I sometimes can't get to all the comments, but I do my best.
Right, right. I mean, you're only one guy, right? So
no, according to HubSpot, I have clones.
Exactly. Yeah, I saw you walking around the office earlier today. It's weird that you're on Skype now. But so what were some of the things, you know, over your 11 years, you know, experience with blogging and creating content, what were some of the things that you got wrong starting out that you could give advice for people to avoid?
Oh, there's so much. I wrote too much about me. It's great to add yourself into a post, and I do start every post with something personal to kind of connect the storyline to the you. But when you write about yourself or you write about your opinions and you, people just are getting an insight into who you are. When I turned it around and wrote about them, and added my insights, but gave them something to do with it all, it changed the landscape. So one is, don't write just about you, write about the space, write about things that are helpful. Two is, I didn't write with my reader in mind, I didn't write with their time frame in mind, etc. So I try to keep my posts around 500 words or so, unless I have a goal in mind. If I'm gonna write something super huge, it's because I want people to bookmark the heck out of it, which gives me an upping in my social bookmarking rankings. Otherwise, I write really short posts that can be consumed in under 3 minutes, because then I'm a known good go-to source that gives you very fast-acting information that you can then run off with. So I become sort of I'm gonna check Chris because he never steers me wrong, it's really short, and I know I'm gonna get in and get out. And even if I don't like the piece, it was really short. And I think that's something that people do wrong, is they write these incredible tomes as if someone's only anxious to read about you. I think another thing to worry about is Me Too blogging. If you're getting your blog topics after reading TechCrunch, then who cares? Everyone else did too. If you are getting your blog ideas from the front of the New York Times, so is everybody else. You really got to cultivate sources way outside the norm and the mainstream, and you really have to try to create information that's your own, not just commentary on other people's. Otherwise, you're just a voice adding to the source, unless you can add something of great value. If you're somebody like a Brian Solis and you can take other people's information and make it into great infographics, bless your heart. If you are somebody who can pull ideas from a lot of different places and synthesize them into something cool, also pretty cool. Most people don't do that. Most people just kind of reconnect and use other people's stuff a second time.
Right, right. I see a lot of, just that post was, published 1,000 times elsewhere. And then, it's just, it's kind of like, even in the social media space, I see that everywhere. Everyone's just republishing without their own opinions and thoughts. And I think you're dead on there, like going outside the norm to find those sources. But speaking of blog topics, you recently started a newsletter, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where basically it's a weekly newsletter where you're feeding out different ideas on kind of what we've been talking about, correct?
Sure. I give up to 10 solid topics a week. Oh, which reminds me, I have to send it out this morning. I have 283 active subscribers, and they're all paying $9.97 a month to learn some ideas about blogging. And in so doing, I give 10 topics every week, plus I give lots of writing advice around the topic. So I give people ideas on how to grow up their blogging community, how to help with professionalism, how to switch from business to pleasure or back. And so it's been pretty good. The responses from people have been really great. It's funny, on the outside, people who haven't taken advantage of the course are all, up in arms. I can't believe he's selling content, because I've never bought a magazine in my life. But people inside the community are writing lots of good stuff and writing lots of thank you letters. So I'm going to stick with the people who are paying me criticisms versus the people who aren't.
Right, right. No, I mean, I saw, so you have a sample of the first newsletter on your blog, and I checked it out last night, and I mean, some of the tips were really good, writing, bringing people into the story of your company, like talking about your next 30 days was one of the examples I thought was pretty good. But yeah, I mean, I'm definitely going to check it out myself. So on your blog, another thing you talk about is, you're a big proponent of professional listening, and you're always stressing that marketers should grow bigger ears. How exactly could that be done?
So if you Google the phrase grow bigger ears, it goes right to a post about it. Beyond that, what I'll say is that there are pro listening tools and that there are some personal listening tools. You can use either. What you're looking to do is you're looking to hear what people are saying about your company, about your products, about you, about competitors in the space, and you're looking to turn that into a business value. So you're trying to say, does this land in customer service? Does this land in PR? Does this land in product support and marketing? Where do I need to put this information? It's not unlike what you do when you take calls in on an 800 number, only it's active listening to the web as opposed to waiting around for someone to ring your phone. People use social tools to complain every single day. I could go on Twitter right now and put in the word HubSpot, and hopefully you get about 90-something percent praise, but there's going to be one person going, man, I just can't figure this out. And what you could do with that is you could drop customer service right on that person's lap and say, wow, I'm really sorry you're having that trouble. Let's walk through it together. Here's my phone number. And that's the kind of experience that keeps people paying the bill. I really strongly recommend Rackspace, which is my hosting service, my website. And the reason I do is because I can tweet, "Dear Rackspace, my site seems to have gone down. Love, Chris." And bam, they'll work on it. It's like 5 minutes later, the site's up because they're listening. And so to me, active listening, no matter what size business you are, is a business value. And it's more important than just trying to figure out how to grow lists and do paid marketing.
Right, right. And if you're not listening, you know, those issues can blow up, blow way out of proportion. So here at HubSpot, we have Rick Burns. He's head of our community. And, you know, when there is a customer or you know, a prospective customer or just someone, you know, bad-mouthing HubSpot, you know, we check the validity of it if they're, you know, raving lunatic or what have you. But, you know, we'll engage with them and try to solve that problem together, you know, instead of letting it fester and kind of grow from there. But, yeah.
Right. So, and Rick's a good guy for that, too, because he's got a good head on his shoulder, and he's definitely the kind of person that inspires warmth when you get to know him.
Right, right. So, all right. So, what are your thoughts on this new social media site, Quora?
It's interesting. I think it's interesting. I think that there's a lot of action going on in there, but I really like Robert Scoble's recent post about it, where he said again, yet again, that he might be wrong about it. Anything Robert loves, I put on my going to die soon list. He's a great bleeding edge technologist. He really is. He's got an incredible capacity for falling madly in love with a site that's going to collapse under the weight of its nerdiness. Friend feed comes right to mind. So Quora is a question and answer site that took everybody by storm, but it wasn't that hard for anyone to change their reaction to what they were going to do with it. Answers.com is going to offer something similar. Mahalo's new version is going to offer something similar. And there's some censorship going on inside of Quora because it's not very business owner friendly. That's going to keep it from being a marketing platform. To the plus, that's great for trying to cut away from spam and stupid spammy answers. To the minus, the more you keep seeing your responses get deleted and edited, you don't want to participate, and you're supposedly adding this to your business acumen, so you're not going to keep it up. So I would not be surprised to see it come and go like a shot or just kind of fall in its level of interest in the near term.
Right, right. I'm still on the fence about it as well. You know, it's one of those things, shiny new object, kind of written all over it. It seems like a beefed up answer of your like yacht or LinkedIn answers kind of, but still waiting to see. I just wanted to get your opinion on it. All right, cool. So who in the social media and marketing space is influential to you? Because I know a lot of people look up to you, Chris Brogan, but who do you look up to in the space?
I always keep one eye on what Dan Zarella is doing. I think that he is sort of the heart and soul of the engine of social technology. I think he's always going to come at it from the numbers and scientist guy mode. So I just add a whole giant scoop of humanity on top of what he does, and then it comes out a little closer to how I would do it. I read a lot of Brian Clark, copy blogger, so he and I talk quite often and about the space. I think as far as the other social media performers, Tamar Weinberg does great stuff. She's just Tamar on Twitter. Valeria Maltoni, who's Conversation Age on Twitter for the Conversation Agent, is interesting. And Jeremiah Aoyang at Altimeter, I keep an eye on him because he sort of looks at the dry analytics side of the space. And so his reports are very helpful. I guess that's kind of my barometer set.
Okay, cool, cool. And you know, with social media and marketing online, where do you see it evolving, you know, into 2011 and into the future?
In 2011, if you're not doing more with mobile, you have a problem. Meaning if your site isn't mobile enabled, if you don't even have a separate maybe fork for how you're doing sales for mobile, you're already at a disadvantage. And by mobile, I don't just mean smartphones, but I do. I definitely mean tablets as well. I think there's a lot more people getting into the tablet space. I think that because of ubiquitous 4G broadband in the US at least, I think that there's a lot more press to have more location services and more mobile services. I don't know that that translates to Foursquare. I'm kind of a non-fan of Foursquare, but Inc. magazine just ran something fairly recently that was, I thought, pretty interesting about how Foursquare could help small business. So I'll keep my eyes open. I think really good email marketing is important in 2011. I think people keep thinking that email is dead, but it's not. And I would say that very much against my will, Facebook marketing seems to be very important. And I am not a giant Facebook fan, least of all a Facebook for Business fan, but people just keep making me feel a lot better.
Right, right. And so speaking of email marketing, you know, you have a very healthy, you know, newsletter like list that you're growing, right? You're reading it, right? So what do you do to kind of grow that list and keep those readers engaged with your email newsletter?
One of the tricks is I don't sell them much of anything. Like I quite often don't have anything particular to sell. I'm just giving them information. So the more you don't ask your list for things, the more they feel like they really actually want to open the mail. Most people's email marketing is bam, bam, bam. I'm selling you. I'm selling you. I'm selling you. Again, if you did that in person, who's going to talk to you? No one's going to come up to you, David, if every time you shake your hand, you're saying, and I'd love for you to buy this thing. But that's how we're using our email. So I think people forget to put human faces on their efforts to market and look at it that way. And so with my email newsletter, I try to send it out and just give, give, give. And then when I make an ask, it's a big ask and people go, I will take action. Chris has given me all this stuff all this time. It seems only fair that I give back. It's the law of reciprocity, which is a basic one. It's in Cialdini's Influence, and it works really well every time. The other thing is we're designing emails for some reason. We use all these service providers that make these incredible web fancy emails, but we're designing for this screen. We're talking 3 inches, not, you know, a giant HTML. It's not my 27-inch iMac that I'm talking to you on. So you need to make it less HTML-y. You need to make it a lot briefer. You need to make it one call to action per mail. This is how sites like Groupon are kicking butt right now. Groupon, at the end of the day, is just an email marketing platform. The fact that people are offering them $6 billion and it's just an email marketing platform teaches you that there's business value in email marketing.
Awesome. Yeah. I would definitely agree. Their valuation seems to rise like every day. So it's pretty interesting to see what's happening there. So Chris, where can people find you online?
HubSpot.com, basically. If you just go to chrisbrogan.com, it's probably the easiest place to find me, and you'll get involved in all my zany places I work. So chrisbrogan.com is plenty fine.
All right, cool. And you can tweet at him at Chris Brogan. He's very responsive on Twitter, which is, you know, awesome. So cool. Thanks for coming on the show, Chris, and we hope to get you back sometime.
Very much a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
All right.